Hey, so I made a Civ 5 Wonder tier list that went over really well, so I thought I'd come back and do the leaders. It was requested in the comments. So, here we go. The way that I'm going to do the tiering system is that this is going to be civilizations as I view their usefulness on deity difficulty in single player. Lower difficulty, like anything that works in deity, is also going to work in lower difficulty, and multiplayer is a completely different game than the single player experience. So let's get right to it. First up is Morocco. They get extra gold from trade routes, a little bit of culture, and they get a bonus that makes desert better and a unique cavalry unit. I believe that Morocco is a C tier civilization for a few reasons. I am going to ignore start bias in the civilization because I have played with start bias disabled for so long that I forget what they have. And no other reason. Morocco is a C tier civ because they get the Kasbah, it makes desert tiles better. Who fucking Ray? Desert tiles are simply bad. Why do I want to make a bad tile better? It doesn't make the bad tile workable. Like, if I have literally any other tile available to me, I'm going to work that tile instead of the Kasbah tile. And this doesn't unlock until Chivalry. Most of my tiles are already improved by that point. Chivalry is a really late tech. Sure, it functions as a fort. Who fucking cares? If this, like, provided fresh water, then yeah, it would be good, but it doesn't, so it's not. If you put this on a desert hill, then it is actually like fairly good. It's like arguably better than a mine because it gives like plus one gold. How do you say? Any non-zero amount of gold allows that gold modifier to be modified by buildings and modifiers in your city. So plus one gold when you have a marketplace. Marketplace? A market and a bank is not one gold, it's one and a half gold. So, like, any non-zero amount is good. But the Kasbah doesn't make me want to work that tile unless it's a hill, and if it's a hill, I can just put a mine on it and kind of be equally as happy, because, like, two production is only slightly worse than one gold, one food, one production. And like, I'm not going out of my way to settle desert tiles anyway. When I'm looking for places to settle, I'm looking for places on a river that have ideally plains, but grassland will also do. And the cavalry unit is not good just because it's a cavalry unit. It kind of doesn't, like, it doesn't matter what is on the cavalry unit, because it has the downside of being a cavalry unit, and cavalry units are simply not worth building, really. Like, you build like one, maybe two cavalry units, and give them medic one and two, and then that's it. They are only useful for capturing cities because they have more than four mobility, and or more than two mobility, so they can move onto a hill tile and then still capture a city, or they can move in and capture the city from beyond the city's bombardment range. And it, like, it doesn't matter how much combat strength they have. Like, they don't need anything other than their mobility to function as cavalry. So yeah, mediocre units, mediocre tile improvement, and this is just kind of whatever. Like, it means that you don't hemorrhage money as badly in the early game, but like, it's nothing amazing. Greece. So Greece, their unique ability makes it really, really, really easy, especially when you take it with patronage, to be allied with a bunch of city-states. The thing about deity is that if an AI wants to be friends with a city-state, you really can't compete with them, almost agnostic of any benefit that you have, because they make money hand over fist. And if the civ has taken autocracy and they have gunboat diplomacy tenet, you cannot buy your way out of that. You simply cannot. The AI builds so many units, especially if they have access to a unique unit, which they love to build. You just can't compete with that level of friendship generation. And so the period of the game from like the Renaissance era to right before the modern era, you can be friends with a lot of city-states, and then that sort of stops happening as the game keeps going because you just don't have the money to compete with an AI who wants to outcompete you. But it does help. It's not nothing. The unique units are not terrible, I guess. Like the unique spearman is fine. It's just fine. And the horseman is a cavalry unit, so it's completely worthless. So, in my mind, Alex isn't outstanding. The bonuses are just sort of niche. They don't really do much for you. The best thing that Alex has going for him is the hoplite because of its increased melee strength. But it's also a spearman unit, so it becomes useless as soon as you get gunpowder. So gunpowder? Gunpowder. So I just kind of don't see the point. Yeah, the staying allied with city states is too high variance. If you take well, no, I walk it back. I'll say B, just because provided you are not playing super aggressively, you can use freedom's friendship over time tenet. What is it called? The Alliance Network, whatever, to stay friendly with city states. And when you stack that with patronage, then your friendship decays so slowly that you can maintain several alliances. Azure Bonapal. This gives you free tech when you conquer a city. There is a marginally better library that has a work of writing slot that gives XP on units and the siege tower. I would say probably B. This may be a shock. Because on paper these traits are quite powerful. I would call them simply average. Because Asher Bonapal's unique unit, the Siege Tower, granted, it does work much, much better against AI than it does against players, because players know how Siege Towers work. The AI kind of doesn't play around them. The thing about this, though, is that for them to be effective, you have to go to war around the time you get mathematics, which is a really early tech. You are much, much, much weaker than the other AI that you are competing with around that time. They have a bigger military than you do. And so having a unit that can only attack cities and does nothing to help you deal with the military that they have that is larger than yours does not necessarily help you capture that city to give you the benefit of your unique ability. And so siege towers, and by extension, most early game units that cannot be used in a defensive capacity are not very useful on deity. Because the AI can simply field a larger army than you can and overwhelm you. The library is. Yeah, fine. This is one of the better unique abilities, or unique buildings rather, I think. If Asher Bonapal had like anything else to go with this, then I would definitely put them in the A tier, just because I think the Royal Library is such a cool ability, or cool building. All of these things will work, like extra EXP on units, and a great work of writing slot. Like, it kind of doesn't matter what victory type you're going for, as if that really matters in the ancient era. This building will just help you in kind of whatever situation you would like to be in. And so it's very strong. But the rest of his abilities are either niche or too difficult to use to make him any higher than B tier. Askia, triple gold from barbarian encampments is Like, God, who cares? This is gonna get you like less than 500 gold over the course of a game. Nobody cares. Land canoe and amphibious promotions strengthening while embarked. Again, who kind of cares? You shouldn't be attacking over rivers anyway, and if you can at all avoid it, you shouldn't have melee units embarked or any unit embarked if you can help it. So this just helps you be stronger in a situation you should be trying to avoid anyway, so I don't find much use in it. The Mandekaluu Cavalry is a cavalry unit, so again, I don't really care what it does, it's not good. And the Mud Pyramid Mosque is really, really strong. This is a temple that just has a bunch of other stuff on it. And by a bunch of other stuff on it, I mean it gives culture as well as faith. So it's basically you have the religious tenet, I think it's like choral music, that gives your temple's culture for free. So yeah, that's quite nice. But overall, this guy doesn't have much going for him. His unique ability does sweet fuck all, and he has a unique cavalry unit and a building that is above average. So that puts him in the C tier because there are other civs that do what he is trying to do much better. Attila is an S-tier civilization. I don't even have to think about it. Raid cities at double speed means nothing. Borrow names from other endgame civs. Why is that even in his description? That has zero mechanical effect. Who cares? Start with animal husbandry. Free technology. Excellent. You love to see it. Not only that, animal husbandry is a really good tech to start with because animal husbandry is where you get your first production boost of the game. Horses are a great tile to work, as are really any pasture resource at all are quite strong. Like if I see a city that I can settle that has like three-ish pastures, I will settle it even if it doesn't give me unique luxury. Those tiles are really good for most of the game. And not only that, it makes the tiles that I want to work already better. Win, win, win. The battering ram is kind of a meme. It's an early game offensive unit. We talked about that a little bit already with Ashur Banipal. I don't value super early game offensive units. These do have a use case. If you find an ancient ruin with your warrior unit and you get the unit upgrade, instead of upgrading to a spearman, you upgrade to a battering ram, and that can allow you to just solo a city state by like turn 10. So that is a use case for that. It doesn't usually happen, but it can. And the horse archer is just quite strong. There's kind of nothing else to it. It's just a. Yes, it's a cavalry unit, but it's a ranged cavalry unit, and that is an important distinction because you don't have to injure yourself to attack. So things like keshiks and horse archers and camel archers, those are like really powerful. But cavalry units that require you to move in, put yourself like in danger of being attacked again, are not great. So easily an S-tier civ. It gives me a free technology that is effectively a production boost when I'm at my most vulnerable, and it makes the tiles that I want to work better, and it has unique units that are not useless. So really good. Caesar is Rome is almost definitely also an S-tier civilization. So 25% production in any buildings that already exist in the capital means that every city that's not your capital should just have 25% more production in like 80% of cases, unless you're building like a wonder or a like a military unit. This bonus should apply. That's really strong. It makes playing wide really, I don't want to say really easy, but it makes it more manageable when you build the library in your capital, and then everywhere else can just build it much faster. it's kind of a big deal. The legionary being able to build roads is quite nice. It has a higher combat strength, which is also not nothing. But I think that the ability to build roads is the bigger deal because these come out about the time that you would be wanting to make those anyhow. And it's crucially prior to you having how do you say? All of the tiles that you're working at this point in the game have not been improved yet, and so your workers' priority should be making that so. And this makes a unit that wasn't doing anything at the time, because if you're not at war, military units just drain your economy. This allows you to use that unit for something productive. And it's productive in a way that is useful for basically every, for not even basically, for every single civ. Every civ wants to have roads. Every one of them. Even something like Carthage, which gets automatic city connections on the coast, you want roads to be able to move your units around quickly. So, this allows you to do that with a unit that was previously just costing you money. And the Ballista is just a better, it's just a better siege unit. So, there's really nothing not to like here. Yes, it's an offensive early game unit, but Rome has the tools to get you in a position that you can be offensive. Civs like Ashurbanipal don't have any sort of production or food or, like any kind of bonus to get you the infrastructure that you need to be in an offensive position. Rome does. And so the siege unit is not negligible. Also, you don't have to point the ballista at a city. You can still use it as a defensive unit if you like. You can't do that with something like a siege tower. Bismarck. Bismarck has a chance to essentially capture, like the prize ship mechanic, barbarians inside a barbarian camp. They pay a little bit less unit maintenance. They have a unique armored unit, a unique tank, which is effectively a cavalry unit, so I think it's worthless. And they have the Hansa, which is arguably the strongest unique building in the game. It's like +5% production for each trade route your civ has with the city-state. That's a lot. Like, a lot, a lot. In the late game, you have like 8 trade routes. That's a 40% production boost. It's so much. It's so much. I think this building alone is enough to put him in, is enough to put him in S tier. The lower land maintenance helps get there. The barbarians joining your side means nothing and the panzer is useless. But the Hansa is such a ridiculous building. All you have to do is make sure that Embargo City-States doesn't pass in the World Congress, and you will outproduce basically any other civ in the game. You have so much production, and production is shortly behind science, the most important yield in the game. The Celts. The Celts are effectively guaranteed to have a religion. Cool. Cool. They have an interesting early game melee unit that gives them faith from kills. It's interesting. The downside is it's a spearman replacement, so they have a terrible upgrade path and become useless when you get gunpowder. So that's bad. And the Celadol, the Cayley Hall? I've heard it said Cayley, so I guess it's Cayley Hall. The +3 happiness is kind of nutty because in every other situation when I get access to opera houses, I look at that +1 culture and think, God, I've got to use like 10, 12 turns of production to get this. This is crap. But +3 happiness is a lot. I want to build that right away because, the like when you get acoustics, your happiness is usually not great because you've been expanding a lot. So this comes at a great time. But the building itself doesn't make the Civ's ability, like, it doesn't make Druidic lore better as the game goes longer. Because you don't really want unimproved forest near your city. You don't really want unimproved anything, much less forest. And the unique unit is kind of useless around the time the Kaylee Hall comes out. So I would say Boudicca is probably mediocre. These bonuses are not harmful. They're really nice for getting a religion. But most of this stuff, even the unique ability, just sort of stops benefiting you after a certain point in the game. And like after industrialization, the Kaylee Hall, this Boudicca is basically just a civ that has Kaylee Halls, and that's it. Poland is probably the strongest civ in the game. An extra social policy when you advance to the next era is fucking insane. It's so strong. Not only that, the ducal stable is amazing. We talked earlier about how pasture tiles are among the strongest in the game. They are very, very strong, especially in the early game. And this makes them better. It makes them a lot better. It gives them plus one gold. More than that, this building doesn't cost gold. It just gives you gold. And even more than that, they have a replacement for the Lancer, and Lancer is without hesitation the worst unit in the entire game. But this unit is so, like, it has its unique ability is so good that it makes me think building a Lancer might not be the worst decision I've ever made. And that is such a huge, huge ask. It's such a huge ask. If you get Winged Hussars and then promote them and then promote them again to helicopter gunships, the heavy charge ability on a helicopter gunship makes them kind of scary because the gunship is obviously not hindered by terrain and they have such high movement that they can proc it basically every turn. So yeah, also 5 movement's not nothing. So absolutely busted racial ability, an infrigging incredible unique building, and a unique unit that is not the best in the game, but good enough to make me think that the worst unit in the game might be worth building one of. Catherine for Russia. Strategic resources give you some more production, and you get double quantity of some strategic resources. So we'll talk about that first. Plus one production from horse iron and uranium, or sorry, plus one production from strategic resources. That's all strategic resources. So that includes uranium, coal, and there might be another one, oil. That's really good. Production is very strong, and we talked about this when we talked about Attila. I want to be working the horse tiles anyhow, and sometimes I will want to be working the iron tiles, especially when I'm trying to put out settlers. So these are tiles that generally I'll want to be working anyway, and it makes them stronger. I highly value civ traits or abilities that make me better at what I was going to do anyhow. And Catherine does that. Double quantity from horse, iron, and uranium is kind of whatever. Double quantity of horses just does not matter because you're not building horse units anyway. Even with your unique unit. Cossack is one of the better cavalry units because it gives you the bonus versus wounded promotion, but it's still a cavalry unit, so I don't want it. And so it doesn't, I don't care how many horses I have, I'm not using them. More iron is only really useful in the case where you want to build a huge navy vis-a-vis frigates. And I kind of don't want to be doing that because boats in Civ 5 are just not that, they're not that great. There's something you build to take like two or three coastal cities, and then they're just a money and production sink that you can't do anything with. And so the amount of iron that I have also kind of doesn't matter. And uranium matters insofar as I can build nuclear power plants. And I don't find myself wanting more uranium in that capacity. Yes, you can build more nukes. You never keep more than like two on hand. You build two, you drop two, and then you build two more. Because like you after you use them, you're not using the uranium anymore. So I don't really need more uranium. The resources that I need more of are aluminum and coal. And this doesn't help me get those. And the Krepost is just kind of whatever. Yeah, this is just kind of whatever. It makes your territory easier to expand. I don't know, it just kind of doesn't do anything. So, Catherine has one really good thing going for her, and it's that the strategic resources provide plus one production. That's still good enough that I think that it lands her in the B tier, because she has a reliable niche. It's fairly easy to get a city that has a strategic resource. So while her ability doesn't do a whole lot, it's easy to trigger. Next is Persia, Longer Golden Ages. That's quite nice. The plus one movement and plus 10% combat bonus strength during a Golden Age is a bigger deal than it might first seem, because this means you can move into a flat tile with a siege unit, set up, and still fire on the first turn, meaning you can bombard a city on the same turn that you move into its bombardment range. That's quite a big deal. It makes early wars much more manageable. It also means that you could theoretically start with a melee unit at three tiles away from a city and then capture it moving from outside the city's bombardment range. The thing about that is, if you have your siege units within two tiles of the city, you really want your melee units between the city and them to like keep the siege units from getting hit, and you want your melee units to be soaking that damage. So that's not as useful for the melee units, but for the siege units, plus one movement is quite significant. Speaking of units, the Immortal heals at double rate. This is a spearman replacement. But healing at double rate is so significant that you can get so much done with these before they obsolete. I think it's worth considering them. Healing at double rate, these heal really, really, really quickly. Especially if you stick a medic next to them, because that doubles too. And so what you do is you wound one of these units by a little bit, and then you move them into bombardment range of the city, and then you move your siege units into bombardment range of the city, and the AI will almost always target a wounded unit over a non-wounded unit, even if it will do far less damage to that wounded unit than it would to, whatever full health unit you have. And so the city will continue pounding and pounding and pounding at this unit that heals for like 40 or 50 a turn and just never kill it. All the while your siege units are pummeling at the city. So this is not insignificant. The Satrap's Court is just a better bank. I was gonna build this anyway. It gives happiness. Yeah, there's nothing not to like. I was going to build this anyway, and it gives a benefit that is not completely meaningless. So I would say Darius is probably an A tier because the bonuses that they have are strong in pretty much any situation. Well, walk that back. They're strong in most situations. Not quite S tier though. If the spearman unit, if the immortal unit that they get upgraded to musketman, then this would be a different story. But because they lose all that benefit essentially when their pikemen are forced to upgrade to the worthless lancer line, it takes a lot of the bite out of the early game momentum that they had. Dido, all cities get a free harbor. Cool. Okay, neat. Units may move across mountains after the first great journal is earned. That's just kind of whatever. I mean, I've played Dido probably like 5 or 6 times, and I've needed to or wanted to move across a mountain 4 times. It just kind of doesn't happen, you know? So, like, it's cool. I'm glad it's in the game. I kind of don't understand why it's locked behind Carthage, because it just never comes up. The Quadrareme is like, what are you gonna do with this? Like, hooray, you can fist barbarians more readily. Great job. And the elephant is a cavalry unit. So, I don't know. Even on coastal maps, the harbor isn't that great. It's just kind of whatever. And a melee naval unit in the early game? Like, again, what are you realistically going to do with that other than make sure your trade routes don't get pillaged by barbarians? They're not even really going to pay for themselves if you're just using them for trade protection. So I kind of don't get what this civ is supposed to do. Elizabeth, +2 movement for all naval units. Would be trash if she didn't have the ship of the line. If England is in the game, no city on the coast is safe. Ships of the line are beyond terrifying. They're so strong. They're one of the few cases where I feel like my navy is not being wasted because anything within 2 tiles of the coast that I can hit is fucking dead. Is just dead. And if they move away from the coast, you can just kill them with the longbowmen. Both of these unique units are quite strong. The extra spy is kind of whatever. It's just kind of whatever. Like, you can spy on 2 civs ahead of you and tech at once, so that's kind of nice. But England's real power comes from it having 2 really strong unique units. I'm going to put them in the A tier just because ship of the line. Well, 2 reasons. One, if things are more than 2 tiles away from the coast, or I guess 3 tiles if you have +1 range, but the more tiles you go inland, the more you start relying on line of sight. Because if there is a hill anywhere between the coast and the tile 3 tiles away that the unit is standing on for your +1 range ship of the line, then you can't hit them. So, what was I saying? If something is 2 tiles plus inland, or you can't shoot it with a ship of the line, then these are just floating money sinks. The longbowman is super powerful. It lets you safely attack cities with a unit that is fresh out the gate. And the unique ability is just sort of whatever. The +2 movement on all naval units means the ships of the line that you were going to be building anyway are more powerful. But for everything else, navies are an accessory. Your army strength is pretty much all that matters. So I think that's why England is not quite S tier. Venice. mean, we all knew this was coming, right? You can't settle new cities, you get double trade routes, and you can buy city-states. They have a unique boat that is just kind of whatever. Like, yeah, it's really strong for what it does. It's not quite turtle ship strength, but it is quite strong for what it does. The problem is, it's a naval unit, so I kind of don't care. And they have a unique great person, which allows you to buy city-states. I kind of don't know how to rate Venice because Venice doesn't play the same game as as any other civ. If you play any civ that's not Venice, it sort of feels like you're playing the same game with different modifiers, but Venice is just, they don't play Civ, if that makes any sense. So, like, I think the safest place to put them is like C tier because the Civ is so high variance. Turtling with good relations with the AI is one of the best ways to win the game. And Venice is the best civ at that. The problem is that if you have, Shaka or Monty or like, Bismarck or some other warmonger civ as your neighbor, Genghis, since I'm looking at him, Attila, as one of your neighbors, they will eat you for breakfast because you don't do anything until you start buying city-states. And in the early game, your trade routes are simply going to be eaten by barbarians. So you don't get strong for a while, and the early game of Deity is the most important because that is when, like, if you don't start snowballing, the AI will. They just will. And if Korea's on the other side of the map, you have essentially already lost because the only way that you prevent that is by eating them yourself. Or hoping that they have Shaka Monty as their neighbors and they eat them for you. And then you have another problem. Shaka Monty are huge. So it's a very high variance civ. But, sometimes you get, William and Maria as your neighbors and you have the best game of your life and Korea's not in the game. But that doesn't always happen. So, you can't bank on that. Guy Yamada from Indonesia. The unique luxuries is an interesting mechanic, and I really like that. I like when a civ can, like, has an ability that makes them able to do something that no other civ can do, and not like, oh, they can build a garden, but it has plus two faith. I mean, again, you're still, like, you're playing the same game, you just have a different number. I mean, the luxuries are nice. They can be difficult to use, especially since generally it is recommended that you play on Pangaea. Excuse me, when playing Deity difficulty, because if an AI has isolation, they tend to run away with the game, and you can't do anything about it. So, Pangaea is typically recommended, which makes Gaja weaker. Their unique building is, I mean, it is blanketly better than the garden because you don't need fresh water to build it. You can just build it in every single city, which is nice. It means that your guild city is not, it doesn't have to be on a river or adjacent to a lake. You can just kind of stick it anywhere. That in and of itself is not like incredible. It's just, like, this is just a garden that gives a little bit of extra faith, and faith is without question the least valuable yield, period. It just is. And the swordsman, yes, there are some nutty upgrades. Yes, this is a sword, but swordsman, so it will keep its upgrades when you promote it to musketman, rifleman, etc. But there's a chance that you get some cursed fucking promotion that makes the unit effectively worthless, like the one that makes you take more damage when defending. Or I think there's one that you just take damage at the end of your turn. Or, in any number of other cursed bullshit that give you a worthless unit. You don't want that. It makes me not want to build these units because it's so high variance. I'm just rolling dice to see if I get one of the good things or if I've just wasted production. So, yeah, they're, yes, they have some good stuff, but it's really hard to get that good stuff. I would rather just play a civ that I know is going to have access to their good stuff. So, I think I'm going to put him in the useless or actively harmful traits because these traits are so hard to activate. And you can just not get them sometimes through no fault of your own. Genghis Khan. You are stronger when fighting city-state units, and all mounted units have plus one movement. I do not care about any of that. You simply do not fight city-state units. That is diplomatic suicide. In almost every situation, you would rather have the bonuses of alliance from a city-state than the benefit of like having it captured. And mounted units are dooky. Yes, the Keshek is an exception to this. The Keshek is really the ketchup? The Keshek is really strong. It is strong enough that I will not put this in the D tier. I will say that Genghis Khan is. God, where do you even say that? So, like, here's the thing. The ability is crap. The Khan is just okay. But the Keshek is god tier. And the Keshek is so good that I think you have to put Genghis in the A tier simply because it's so easy to get logistics on these. They produce you so many great generals, and the enemy can do so little about it. Genghis has some of the most intense concentrated focus fire of any civilization in the game, with the exception of maybe Arabia, which we'll get to in a moment. But that's all he has. The Keshek is the only reason that you want to play Genghis. So, yes, they're quite strong, but only because Kesheks are so, like, ridiculous. Sweden. 90 influence with a great person gift to a city-state. When are you ever going to do that? When, like, okay, sure, you can use three uses of a great prophet and then give the last use to the city-state to get an ally. Cool. Hooray. Like, I guess. Seems kind of cheesy, but I guess it works. The Karolian is, I don't know, is above average. Like, March is a great promotion. I love to have it. The only thing is, you don't tend to use riflemen for that long, so these guys obsolete quick. You have to get rifling, and then build, 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 before you research great whatever tech gives great war infantry. So, replaceable parts. Yeah, it's a cool unit. You just don't get to use it for very long. Yes, they keep the March promotion, but you have to just shit out so many of these for it to matter. That it's difficult to utilize, and the Hakkapeliitta is a Lancer replacement, so I'm not even going to acknowledge its existence. These are mediocre bonuses. You will use this 90 influence thing like once or twice in a game. You are simply not going to use it. The 10% boost to great person generation is fairly negligible, and it gives your opponent a benefit. I don't want to give my opponents no damn benefits. If this disproportionately favored me, maybe, but it doesn't. Ugh. Ugh. I don't like it. And like not only that, this is only active if you're friends. And the rest of your unique abilities are unique units, which only matter if you go to war. And if you go to war, you're going to suffer diplomatic penalties with other civs, which makes it harder to be friends. So it's really hard to use these. I don't know. I don't get what Sweden is supposed to play like. Are you supposed to go to war and make use of your unique unit and whatever this thing is? Or are you supposed to be friends and love city-states? I don't get it. I mean, I get it from a historical perspective. This is Sweden in like the 20th century, and this is Sweden in like the 16th century. I get it. I don't like it. Ethiopia. 20% combat bonus when fighting units from a civ with more cities than you makes you stronger in the early game when you are at your most vulnerable. I like abilities that do this. I like abilities that just work and help you when you are doing things that you were going to do anyway at a time when you are at your most vulnerable. So this is exactly the kind of ability that I think is great for a civilization to have. It just works and it helps you when you are at your weakest. And you don't have to do something that you weren't gonna that you were not gonna do. You just play the game how you were going to, and you're stronger for it. They also get the Mehel Safari, which is just kind of whatever. Like drill one's fine, like that's cute. It helps, but it's not amazing. The near capital bonus, like it can be quite good, but if you're fighting near your capital, things have probably already gone tits up. So I don't value that super highly. What I do value though is the Stele Steel. This is a monument replacement, and it gives more faith than the shrine. It's just really good. So, I will say this is strong in some situations because, like, the better you're doing, the more territory you have, and the more like you can expand, the further away from your capital you are. Because like, this benefit does nothing after you get like, I think it's like 5 tiles away from your capital, you get no benefit. So, like, the better you're doing, the less these matter. So, yeah. I think I've just talked myself into putting them into B tier. They're really good for playing tall, they're quite good at being defensive. The monument is an incredible monument replacement because it's just better than a shrine. But the unique unit kind of doesn't do anything. And the combat bonus isn't applicable in all situations. So they're okay. Their stuff is always on, more or less, but it's not insane. Denmark. I want this guy to be good so bad. Vikings are so cool. But Harald is not. Embarked units have plus one movement. Well, we talked about this with I think Askia already. Like you don't embark. You don't want to embark. It makes your units more vulnerable. If they get shot, they just fucking die. Don't embark with your units. It makes me better at something that I want to avoid. I don't like those abilities. Melee units pay no movement cost to pillage. When am I ever going to use that for real? Like, you only pillage tiles if you're trying to make a unit not die this turn. You don't want to pillage tiles of a city that you are going to capture if you can at all avoid it. It's trying to incentivize me to do something that I'm trying to avoid. The Berserker is, I mean, it's just kind of whatever. Like, longsword replacement, hooray. But I don't know, it just kind of doesn't do anything. It's a little bit stronger, it doesn't require iron. It's just, I don't know, I'm not blown away by it. compared to something like, the Immortal, which heals at double rate. This is just slightly stronger. And the Norwegian Ski Infantry, which I believe has double movement in hills. Strong frontline unit of the mid game that specializes in operating in snow. Bonuses. I think. Okay, if this is just a combat bonus, then I really don't care. See, this is how little I play Herald. These bonuses are just so mediocre. Like, this might as well just be a vanilla civ with no bonuses. This civ does absolutely nothing. Going from the worst of the worst to some of the best, Arabia is super strong. So, caravans have extended range. That's nice. You would prefer to use cargo ships, but, like, I'm not going to turn this down. It's not useless. Your trade routes spread the home city's religion twice as effectively. That's kind of cool. It's not that good, but it's kind of cool. Oil resources are doubled. Now we're talking. Now we're talking. When we talked about Russia, we talked about the resources that I want doubled. Chiefly, I want more aluminum and more coal. But third on that list is oil. Loves me some oil. Oil allows you to build some really strong units, specifically planes. And Arabia just gets more of them. So that's good. It's never not good. The bazaar is. It allows you to do something that no other civ can do. Like, say you have two die tiles near your city and one marble tile. Marble tiles just do not. Like, they don't follow the same spawning. Rules as other luxury resources, or it really seems that way, where you won't get a city with like three of them. They're just sort of smattered around the map in ones. But if you build a bazaar, which is really easy to do because it's a market replacement, you get two sources of marble, which means you're basically guaranteed a trade. You can make so much money as Arabia because you can trade so many resources that any other civ just wouldn't have access to. Oh, there's only one source of whales on the whole map because there only ever is. Well, bada bing, bada boom. Now you have one for you and one for your friend. It's so nice. And not only that, you get an extra bonus from oil. It's weird, but sure, I guess. I don't know, do they sell oil in like the bazaar at the Middle East just in oil drums? Is that what this is implying? I don't really get that, but it's cool. And the camel archer, which is just it, like insanely fucking strong. If I see one of these as a city state a built unit from a militaristic city state, then I will bend over backwards to get them. This is so insanely strong. That even if this was the only thing they had going for them, I would still put them in S tier. I mean, we already had one of those civs. The Mongols here, all they have is a worse version of the camel archer, and they're still A tier. That's how strong these ranged cavalry units are. They're so good. Hiawatha is probably the worst civ in the game. Hot take, I know. So, to understand what's wrong with him, we have to go through all of his abilities because they're all bad. Not only are they all bad, they're all harmful. Except maybe the Mohawk Warrior. So, units move through forest and jungle in friendly territory as if they were roads. That's great on paper, and it does mean you can move around in your own territory more quickly before you build roads. But. And this is a huge but. Let's say that you have a forest tile adjacent to just a plains tile that doesn't have a forest. If your unit starts the turn in that plains tile and then moves into the forest, it costs all of its movement to do so because you're moving into rough terrain. It's not like moving onto a road tile. It just ends your turn. So you can't use them in the way that you would intend to use roads. Or let's say you have two forest tiles on either side of a river, and you have, what is it, engineering that allows you to build bridges? You can't move from that forest tile across the river into another forest tile as if there were a bridge. It costs your whole turn. So you still have to build roads anyway. And like even if those things were true, you still have to build railroads later in the game because they don't function as railroads, and you like the point of roads is to move fast. And this ability just does not accomplish that in any meaningful sense of the word. The Mohawk Warrior is just, it's just whatever. Like bonus in Forest Jungle, yeah, that's okay. Like in on any other Civ, I would say this is like a cutesy little benefit because I want to be on those tiles anyway. Because rough terrain gives you a combat bonus, and so this is incentivizing you to do something you're going to do anyway. But like again, it's just kind of whatever. It's above average, but when you stick it on the chassis of Hiawatha, it's just so gross. The Longhouse is the worst offender. This does not have the plus 10% production of a workshop. So it gives it just it gives less production than the building it replaces. It's a worse it's a worse workshop. Yes, it gives plus one production from each worked forest tile. You don't want to work forests. Forests are a shitty tile type. You want either either a farm or a mine on every tile you can get. Forests have one purpose, to be chopped. That is it. The longhouse is only really beneficial to fur tiles, which you should arguably chop, and deer tiles, and that's it. It's a terrible building that is actively harmful to you. Spain is high variance. Yet you can have a nutty game of Spain where you find, El Dorado or Lake Victoria or like King Solomon's Mines as your second city, and then like GG, you win the game. You have already won the game. Playing the rest of it is a formality, or like the Great Barrier Reef, and yeah, you just win. But when you don't find a wonder as Spain, you just want to throw yourself from a high place because the Civ doesn't do anything if you don't have a wonder. They have a knight, or sorry, a cavalry unit that can settle cities. Cool. Like it's a mounted unit. I don't give a shit. Why do I want to build a more, I don't know. Like why do I want this? Why don't I just build a settler? Why do I need to play a civilization just so my settler can have combat strength? Seems weird. And they have the Tertio, which is like, yeah, it's fine. I like the Tertio. Like it's just a stronger version of the musketman, which you use for a relatively long period of time. So that's quite good. I like that a lot. But it's not good enough to make up for an ability that doesn't do anything and a completely worthless unique unit. So when you play Spain, you're essentially saying, okay, I would like a slightly stronger musketman and the chance to simply win the game, and if I don't do that, an ability that does nothing. So they're just super high variants. Kamehameha? 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 Polynesia. The ability to embark over oceans immediately is interesting. I don't think that it's easy to say how good that is. It's just okay, I think. It's not game breaking. Plus one sight when embarked is just kind of a ribbon ability. It doesn't super do anything. And the combat strength, if within two tiles of a Moai, is, shall we say, inconsistent. This is typically going to mean it only applies in defensive situations. So you can't use it when you're invading most of the time. The Maui itself is, again, shall we say, interesting. It's difficult to use, is what it is. If you can't build a lot of these things and they kind of don't do anything, and even when you do build a lot of these, all they give you is culture. So, unless you've got a coast that kind of wraps around along itself, these don't really do a whole lot for you. In my mind, they're kind of a worse version of the chateau because these need so much space to produce a tile. Like you have to build like three or four tiles to have one workable tile. So they're just kind of hard to use. The Maori Warrior is, I guess, it's fine. The terrifying opponent is really nice, especially on a melee unit. You'll love to see that because this will keep its upgrades throughout, the rest of the game. You'll love to see that. This is one of the better early game units because it is useful in pretty much any situation, defensively or offensively. But because the rest of the abilities don't really do anything, I'm gonna say that these are mediocre and this goes in the C tier. They just kind of don't do enough. And it's too hard to utilize the heads. Okay. Maria. Did I miss Gandhi? Why haven't we done? I did miss Gandhi. I skipped him. So unhappiness from number of cities is doubled. Unhappiness from number of citizens halved. It's just okay. Gandhi's really good at building tall, which is an effective strategy. The thing is, though, his other abilities don't really do anything. He has a war elephant, which I do not care about. Like, yes, it's a how do you say, how, what am I trying to say here? Yes, it is a ranged horse unit, but it has three movement, so I don't care. The reason that Keshiks and camel archers are dangerous is because they have range and high mobility. The elephant doesn't do that, so it doesn't fill the function that it needs to as a ranged cavalry unit. And the Mughal fort is a defensive building, like walls and castle and arsenal and the whatever. Those are the last buildings you should be building in any city. Really, if you can at all help it, because they don't contribute to your economy. They are just there to make sure you don't get eaten. I would rather build any other building if I can at all help it. So, most of Gandhi's abilities just sort of don't do anything. They're just sort of there. So I'm again going to put him in the mediocre bonuses. We're on Maria. Resource diversity grants twice as much gold for Portugal and trade routes. They get a what do you call it? A caravel replacement that allows you to make some money, and they get a unique improvement that you can only build in city-state territory. These abilities are not actively harmful. They also do sweet fuck all. Playing Portugal is like playing a civilization that has no bonuses. You simply will not notice the extra income from resource diversity. Caravels. You are going to get so little money from these, it doesn't matter, and these don't upgrade to a unit that matters. Like they're a naval unit. They don't do anything. And a what do you call it? A unique improvement that you can build in city-state territory to give you their stuff. If they're not coastal or they don't have a tile that you can like build this on that doesn't have a resource, then you can't even use this. They have to be coastal. So, this just doesn't work half the time. And if you're allied to the city state, which you want to be, Then this also doesn't do anything. Because the city state just gives you the resource anyway. So it's just a bad civ. Austria, also known as Venice Light. The ability to buy city states is a unique mechanic, and I really like unique mechanics. How useful is it? Questionably. The benefits that you get from being allied to city states is usually something that owning the territory will not give you. Like a unique unit, or a lot of culture, or in the early game, faith, which you kind of care about in the early game, I guess. Whereas owning the territory doesn't give you those things. So it's difficult to evaluate because the use case for this is you get allied to a city state on the other side of the world next to a civ that you want to eat, and then you annex them and buy an airport and you fly all your units over. That's the use case. You don't really want to be eating other city-states, especially ones that you're allied with, because you would rather just have the benefit. Like, if this worked on city-states that you weren't allied with, then I think it would be better. But because you're already getting the bonuses that you would want to get from that city-state, why do I want to annex them? I don't know. They also have a cavalry replacement that I simply do not care about. Yeah, sure, they can see further. Hooray. Yeehaw. You're going to get planes soon. Who cares? And the coffee house, which is a, it's a windmill that doesn't require a hill and gives you more great people generation. I tend to think that this is like a garden replacement or something because of how, like, a production building that gives you more great people generation? That's kind of weird. I like it. It's cool. It's a nice building. It's just sort of a weird mashup. It's kind of like the library that Ashurbanipal has in that way. Yeah. I would say this is probably a B-tier civ. It's just... No, it's not even that. I'd say C. Below average. Because the diplomatic marriage is incentivizing you to do something that you don't really want to do. You would rather continue that alliance rather than eat the territory. And the horse unit does nothing, and the unique building is not strong enough to make up for the other two abilities not doing what you want them to do. Montezuma. All right, Montezuma is definitely above average. The culture from units killed is never not good. It means going to war or fighting barbarians in the early game is better for you. You probably want to do those things anyway. You also have the Jaguar Warrior, which has a really strong heal on kill ability. You love to see that. And because it's a melee unit, it can keep that unit it can keep that promotion indefinitely, all the way up to infantry and mechanized infantry. So that's super strong, super good. It has a combat bonus in terrain that I already want to be in, so that's quite strong. And on top of that, the Floating Gardens is A, simply a strong building in its own right, but B, plus 15% food. This is one of two buildings in the game that modify the flat food yield of your city. It's this, or the Temple of Artemis, which you will never build on deity, period. So, this can give Monty some huge cities, and that's really strong. It is a slept-on building. So, to summarize, there's an ability that is just good for any playstyle. There is a building that is just good in any situation. And there is a unique unit that is just good because it incentivizes things that I want to be doing anyway. So, Where is Montezuma on this list? There he is. Nope, that's Pakal. Actually, yeah, where is the little bugger? Okay, well, looks like he might not be on this list. Anyway, I would say he's an A-tier civilization because he's not game breaking. He's definitely not competing with Poland. He's definitely not competing with Arabia. But all of his stuff is good, kind of regardless of what you want to be playing. So, A-tier civilization. Napoleon. Right. Napoleon. Culture is kind of a meme. Like, yes, it works. It's also kind of boring, I think. The chateau is fine. It's a better version of the Mallory, I think, because this only takes one tile to give you plus two, plus one. And, like, that's better than taking, like, two or three tiles to get that kind of yield, which is just innately better. Functions as a fort, which is sort of irrelevant, I think. Things that function as a forts don't super matter in single player, not really. And the musketeer is just it's just better than the musketmen, which is one of the better units to have a replacement for because you use musketmen for such a long relative period of time. So the unique ability is quite niche. The chateau is just okay. Like plus two culture is fine. It's just fine. If this had like a production or a food, then it would be incredible. But because it doesn't, it means you're at the mercy of whatever tile you're putting it on. So if you're not putting it on a grassland tile, then you're really going to struggle for growth if you're working chateaus. And the musketeer is just good. It is just simply good. So I'd say Napoleon is probably B tier because, like, if you're not playing the culture game, then their unique ability doesn't do anything. The musketman is only around for ultimately a small portion of the game, even though it's around for longer proportionally to other melee units. And the chateau is just sort of whatever. Like, it's nice, don't get me wrong. I like to have them. But you can't work too many of them, or you said you just never grows. And so I think for that reason, I've talked myself into putting them back down into C. Next, Nebuchadnezzar. You get a free great scientist very early in the game when you're at your most vulnerable. You earn more great scientists. You get a defensive bonus for your walls building. We've already talked about how I feel about walls. They're a meme. Like, they're the last thing that you should be building, if you can at all help it. And you get a slightly better bowman that can withstand melee attacks better. You know what I'm going to say about this unit, right? It is incentivizing me to do something that I am trying to avoid anyway, which is my archery units getting melee attacked. I'm trying to avoid that anyway. So if things are going well for me, I will never notice this bonus. Babylon's strength comes from them getting a free great scientist when they discover writing. So they essentially have double the science output of any other civ in the game at that point. And they earn great scientists faster. Babylon is good because they get science. These two things might as well not exist. So I'm going to put them in the B tier. No, I can't do that. I can't do that. I have to do A. Just because science is the best yield in the game, and Nebuchadnezzar gets more of it. If either of these two abilities were not entirely negligible, then they would be up here. But they're not. So they're not. Oda Nobunaga, from Japan. The Fighting at full strength, even while damaged, is. It's annoying, is what it is. You don't super notice it when you're playing as Japan because you don't want to attack if your attack would leave your unit at like 20% HP. Like you want to end your turn with enough HP that you feel confident you're not gonna die before your next turn. Whereas if you're not playing Japan and you're attacking into a unit that has like 20% HP, then it's a huge ball ache because, I mean, you clearly have to kill the unit. You can't just not do anything about it. But you're taking more damage for the privilege of doing so. So this is an annoying ability to fight against, but it's not super strong to fight with. Plus one culture from fishing boats and plus two culture from atolls. This is, I think, greatly exaggerated how much culture this is actually going to give you. Three fish in a city is a number that I would consider a lot. Now, these are tiles that you are going to work anyway, especially the fish tiles. The atolls are sort of whatever. So I do like that. I really like being incentivized to do something that I was going to do anyway, and this does that. It just doesn't do that much. The zero not requiring oil is a complete non sequitur. You will have enough oil, or you should, to build some planes. So these not taking oil is, I just like, it's not that big of a benefit. Not really. And samurai, yeah, okay, so they have some extra combat strength. The Great General's 2 promotion is quite nice. I don't think these are good enough to justify existing. Like, Great General's 2 isn't enough. Not on a melee unit. Because, again, like, melee units' jobs are not to initiate combat and get XP. Their job is to sit still and soak damage. So, if these things are not parked, if you're not actively sieging a city, your melee units are not getting experience. So it's relatively difficult to get benefit of the Great General's 2 promotion on this unit. They can also build fishing boats. So this is an interesting promotion because typically to build fishing boats you need to build an expendable unit, the fishing boat, the workboat rather, to do so. At this unit just builds them and it doesn't expend the unit, so that's really cool. I love that. These are not as good as legionaries though, because A, you need way more roads than you need fishing boats, and B, you get these at steel, friend. You should just have fishing boats. So, like, by the time you get the unit that can build your fishing boat, you should have already had them by a long time. You unlock fishing boats at sailing. If you are so inclined, sailing can be the second tech you unlock. So, like, boiling this down to the things that matter. I have an ability that incentivizes me to try to get my units killed to get more use out of their fighting at wounded or their like their Bushido ability. I have some comfy culture from fishing boats, which is, you know, it's just good. I like that. A unique unit that like their ability doesn't really do anything, and then a unique unit whose ability doesn't really do anything. So I would consider these to be mediocre bonuses. Pakal, After researching theology, receive a great person at the end of every Mayan lung count cycle. Each bonus person can only be chosen once. This is a lot of great people that you just get for free. That's really strong. this is kind of just like Babylon plus, because you get a great scientist fairly early in the game, and then you keep getting great people. Granted, it's not more great scientists like in the case of Babylon, but it's still great people. You get a great scientist and then a great engineer, and then some other stuff that you sort of don't care about as much. You get the Atlatlist, which I don't know. I this is just kind of whatever. Who cares if it's available like earlier? Archery is one of the first techs that you can get, so I kind of don't see the use case for this. What are you realistically going to do with an archer that comes out slightly earlier? Come on. And the pyramid is super strong. It is a shrine that gives science. So you don't want to shoot yourself in the foot because you're like, okay, well, it's turn 12. I've researched pottery. I must switch my production to shrine now or I simply will not get a religion. And then when you do that, it's like you built a library and not a shrine. It's really good. I like that. I would say this is one of the stronger civs in the game. Like, it's low S, high A. Getting so many different great people is good for every playstyle. It's just really strong. The shrine is good in all situations, and the Atlatlist is sort of whatever, but, you know, getting this many great people is going to compensate for having a lackluster unique unit. Pachacuti. So ignoring movement costs when you move into hills is kind of bonkers. You want to be moving into rough terrain anyway, and this works with workers. So you can move onto a hill and start building a mine on the same turn. No maintenance costs for improvements on hills. That means roads and railroads and pretty much nothing else, I don't think. You will notice that your roads are much cheaper. The slinger is, again, whatever. Like, this doesn't really do anything. Like, why do I care about an archer replacement that is just like slightly tweaked numbers? It just like, yeah, you can withdraw. Cool. It's a failsafe for something I'm trying to avoid anyhow. And the terrace farm is really high variance. There's kind of no other word for it. Unless you are adjacent to like three mountains, this doesn't really do. I would just kind of rather have a mine, right? Like, you can just get food from rivers. This doesn't become nutty until you have tons of mountains, and you just can't guarantee that. So, I mean, this is one of the more interesting tile improvements, and I really like it. But as far as consistent performance, this is not it. So, I would say this is probably B tier, just because the inconsistency of the terrace farm, the slinger is a non sequitur. The main thing that they have going for them, I think, is the movement bonus in hills, which is simply always useful. This also works in enemy terrain, for what it's worth, so that's pretty cool. Pedro II from Brazil. Okay, sure. This is probably the civ that I play the least, because it feels like they just don't do anything until half the game is over. And the thing about Deity is you don't really care about that half of the game nearly as much as you care about the half that came before it. You are at your weakest proportionally the earlier into the game that you go. So you want those bonuses then, not when your fucking ideology comes out. So, like, and the ability that this gets isn't even that good. Like, Golden Age points? Hooray! Like, God. And it's kind of bonkers too. Like, how do you say this? If you're at war with a civilization, you have minus 100% tourism with them. Why? So you have to cut your tourism with a sieve to get Golden Age points to increase your tourism with a sieve. It's fucking bass-ackwards, is, I tell you what. The Rizzlewood camp is just kind of whatever. Like, if this came out earlier, then maybe it would be cool, but the fact that you have to wait until, like, Acoustics is in the Renaissance era, isn't it? You've chopped all your jungles by now. Like, you shouldn't have that many left. So, I don't know. I am not a fan of Pedro. The Shoshone, founded cities start with additional territory. Insanely annoying, but also really cool when you have it. Combat bonus in friendly territory. I don't really like being incentivized or like given a failsafe for something that I'm trying to avoid anyway. I want to be given a bonus for something that I want to be trying to do. The Pathfinder being able to choose its promotion or choose its benefit from Great Ruin or Great Ruins from ruins is just kind of whatever. It's cool, it can help, but it's also highly variable. Sometimes you just don't find ruins, and their unique ability is a mounted unit, so I don't care about it. I would call these mediocre bonuses. It's not useless, and they're not harmful. They're just like, this is comfy, this is useless, and this has high variance. So I can't deny that it gives them something. It's just not enough. Production, Egypt, production towards wonder consumption. Consumption? Construction is nice. Like, you want to try to be building wonders, especially certain key wonders, like Leaning Tower of Pisa, the Porcelain Tower, things like that. And this helps you do that, so that's quite nice. You're not going to be wonder spamming in the early game. You simply are not. But this will help you get some key wonders that will can make or break the game. And so that's just really good. This is just a better version of the temple. It has a downside, but I mean, this shouldn't be happening anyway. So, like, if your city's being captured, you have more to worry about than the downside of your temple building. So this is just a temple that gives plus two happiness, and you love to see that, especially at this point in the game, because this is when you're expanding. And the War Chariot, which is an archery replacement, yeah, this isn't good. It can't move and attack. And if it moves into any rough terrain at all, it just stops. It just stops. So it's really difficult to actually use this in the hit and run method that you would like to use the War Chariot for. I believe this thing can't hit and or move, attack, and then move back. I believe that's the case. But regardless, the rough terrain penalty is enough to make this unit effectively worthless because it's so hard to get just a big flat slab where these things are actually useful. So, realistically, you have extra wonder construction and a tomb that gives you a happiness benefit. So, I would say Ramses is probably the B tier because building certain key wonders can make or break the game. Rankum Hang for Siam. Bonuses from city states is increased. That's really nice, but Siam doesn't get anything to help you keep those bonuses. So you are kind of at the mercy of just happening to get them or like hemorrhaging money to buy these bonuses. And if the AI wants to compete with you, you can't win. Because the Siam doesn't get anything to help their economy either. What they do get is a horse unit that I don't care about. And a watt that, yeah, I mean, it's a university that gives some culture, which means that if you take the tradition policy that gives you a free culture building, you can get Watts with them if this is the only other culture building that you have available to you. So that's really cool and niche and not at all worth it because you have to delay that policy for so long that it doesn't matter. But you can do it. So I don't know. They're not harmful. They don't do nothing. They're just too difficult to achieve for what they are. And plus three culture on a building that I want to be building anyway as soon as I can isn't enough to make an ability that doesn't do anything and a useless unique unit worth casting my eye upon. Korea, plus two science from all specialists, incredibly good. I mean, A, it's science, and B, I kind of want to be working specialists if I can anyhow. So it's a double whammy of incentivizing things I want to do anyway. And this also applies for great percentile improvements. If you have a great percentile improvement, it is specifically because you want to work it. You don't build a great percentile improvement and then not work the thing. So this is just it. Receive a great tech bonus when you build a scientific building or wonder in the capital. You want to be doing these things anyway, and this incentivizes you to do them. You have a siege weapon that is really good at defense. And when I say really good, I mean really good. The combat strength is comparable to artillery. It's really strong as a defensive unit. It's not as good against cities, but oh my goodness, is this thing good at making sure you don't get eaten. And the turtle ship is, correct me if I'm wrong here, stronger than the ironclad, which is two upgrades. Or sorry, which is what this unit upgrades to. There are not stronger naval units on the sea until destroyers. They're kind of nutty. So, I mean, it goes without saying. Sejong is just incredibly powerful. It has abilities that incentivize you to do what you were going to do anyway. One of the most powerful defensive units in the game. And this thing can. How do you say this? If you have turtle ships, you're not scared of ships of the line. They're that strong. Yeah, the combat strength on these is enough that I am willing to overlook that they are a melee naval unit. You can dominate any navy in the game defensively with turtle ships. Shaka, you get less unit maintenance. All units require less experience to earn the promotion. Both of these things are really strong because it means stacking unit EXP is more viable, which is what you want to be doing anyway. It's incentivizing a thing that I want to be doing anyhow. This makes units that come out of your cities have more promotions. And that is kind of the point of building experience buildings. So, yeah, that's quite strong. These unique promotions for early game melee units are quite good, I think, because the bonuses are significant. Each one of them is noticeably better than the shocker drill that they replace, and they are good on really any unit that you can stick them on. And when we talk about their unique unit, the MP, yes, it is a pikeman replacement, but it upgrades to riflemen, so it doesn't become like useless as you get more tech. If this became a Lancer, then this would be a completely different story, but these get their unique promotions from your unique building, and then they continue to be good because you can keep upgrading them as you get tech. Shaka's only real downfall is that he doesn't have ways to buff his science or production, but because his military is so good, that almost doesn't matter. Shaka is quite strong, but he does fall off. Eventually, your units will not get the benefit of the Ikonda anymore when they when you start being able to produce musketmen and riflemen. So you will be quite powerful for the early game when you are at your most vulnerable, so that is the most important time of the game. But as the game continues to go along, you will notice these benefits less and less. The unit maintenance will always be good, and the unit promotions will always be good. But these two things, you know, it's what keeps him from being strong in all situations. He is strong in the early game and then becomes basically a vanilla sieve. Suleiman, the Ottomans. So all units having the prize ship promotion kind of doesn't matter. Like you can do some cheesy stuff with like barbarian camps and capture the ships that they produce and then gift them to city states for some influence. That's kind of cute, I guess. But ultimately, it's not that much because it's five per, so it's not that great. They have a unique lancer that I do not care about, and the Janissary is, it's one of the units that heals when it kills a thing, so that is obviously quite strong. But effectively, the Janissary is the only good thing that Suleiman has going for him because everything else, like, I don't care about the navy. I just don't. And I don't care about horses. I just don't. So it would appear that Suleiman is another one that didn't get added to whoever made this list. If I would put Suleiman in probably the D tier because these just don't do anything at all. Yeah, at all. Theodora, you can choose an extra belief when you found a religion. This can be anything. This can be another pantheon if you like, which, pantheons are pretty good. Most pantheons are better than some of the, actual traits that you can choose for a religion. And that's saying something. However, this is really all they have going for them. This is an early ranged naval unit. I just don't care about my navy. And this is a unique horseman that has less movement than a normal horseman, which is the only reason you build horsemen. Like, the only reason you build mounted units is because they have a lot of movement. This has less movement. I don't care about its combat strength. I care that it can move. So, being able to choose another belief when you found a religion is not good enough to make up for two completely worthless unique units. And you are not even guaranteed to get a religion. It would be nice if this thing like gave faith from kills or something so that you're not at the mercy of just natural faith generation. Like for real, why doesn't this civ have something that helps you get a religion if their unique ability is entirely dependent on getting one? If you don't have a unique building, or you don't have a natural wonder that gives faith, then kind of your only option for generating faith is founding lots of cities so that you can build lots of temples and shrines. Or taking theology? God, piety. Taking piety as your opener, which is just a terrible idea. You absolutely must, non-negotiable, take liberty or tradition as your opening policy. Ideally, tradition because it's just better. But Yeah, the Civ has to bend over backwards to get a benefit that isn't that good. It is not unusual for you not to get a religion at all on Deity because the AI is just better at getting one than you. So there's a good chance that you're just not going to get anything out of the Civ at all. America, via Washington. Land units have more sight. Yeah, that's cool, I guess. It means that if you get a siege unit or like an archer unit with plus one range, then you can park that ranged unit or a melee unit 3 tiles away from a city and still have vision on it and use that plus one range to pummel it from there without having to move in and out every turn. So that's nice. The Minuteman gets ignored terrain cost, which is, I mean, let's not mince words here. That's pretty strong. I really like that. The drill one to go with that is also really nice. So this is definitely an above average unit. And like the best thing about this unit, I think, is that it is a musketman. So it is going to be relevant for the like the only unit that is, the only melee unit that is relevant for longer than a musketman is infantry. And Minutemen come at a point in the game when like your ability to punch above your weight matters the most. So these are they're good. They're good. There's really no two ways about it. Norse terrain cost, a free promotion. The Golden Age from Victories is kind of whatever. I don't really care about that. It's not like you're going to proc a Golden Age off kills. You're just not going to do that. And the B-17 having evasion out of the gate and siege one is like evasion's nice. Evasion means that you don't have those situations where it's like, okay, I'm like 90% sure it's safe because I already attacked with one bomber and I did an air sweep with one of my fighters, so I've done 2 attacks and I haven't been hit yet. And then you go to attack and you go from like, 80 to 0 HP because lol JK, there was a mobile SAM in the back. Like that doesn't happen to you as often. So that's nice. But the siege promotion is you don't you just don't attack cities with bombers. You just don't. So I mean it's nice that it's free, but it's also like thanks. I think. What am I gonna do with it? The 50% discount when purchasing tiles is a it's a slap in the face really because there's another civ that just gets this for free. Like, they just eat terrain for free. Like, Pocatello just gets the tiles. You don't have to buy them. So, I don't know. America's only real strength. Like, the only thing that I'm super excited about is the Minuteman. The B-17 is just kind of whatever. So, I would say they're mediocre to high variance. The Musketman, in and of itself, is not, or the Minuteman, rather, is not enough to carry this civ. William, 50% of the happiness you from luxury resources is kept if you trade it away. The AI never uses this. It makes me sad. But you, the player, can use it. It's okay, I guess. Like, realistically, this is gonna mean you get like an extra, like, 2, maybe 4 happiness. You can do cheesy stuff where you take commerce, and when you get the +2 happiness from every luxury resource, and then you trade away your last comp, you keep 3 instead of 2 happiness because the resource is worth 6 now. So that's cute. But again, realistically, it just means that you're going to be getting +6 happiness instead of +4 when you trade away 2 copies of your last thing. Yeah, the ability is a complete non sequitur. I don't know how many luxuries the devs thought you would be trading away, but it's not this many. The Sea Beggar is really easy to get logistics on. Naval melee units getting logistics is probably like the worst unit that could possibly get logistics, but you can get it. So I don't know. The Sea Beggar is kind of a joke. Polders are the reason you play the Netherlands. These are re if you don't have marshland or floodplains, then you can't build polders. And polders come at guilds. That's quite late for a tile improvement. I mean, consider that every other tile improvement that is like not a unique one is something that you unlock after like two techs. This is relatively deep comparatively. So it takes a while to get, and then it's high variance, and the other two abilities are something that just sort of don't matter. Don't get me wrong. The Netherlands are one of my favorite civs. I love them, and I love polders. But they're too high variance, and when you don't get to build a bunch of polders as the Netherlands, it's just a miserable fucking experience. You hate it so much. And then lastly, we have China via Wu-Sietan. Better great generals, cool. I'm incentivized for something I want to do anyway, fight near a great general. You get more great generals. You love to see that. At the very least, that means you get more territory because you can pop these as effectively like what used to be culture bombs. You get a unit that just gets logistics when you produce it. That's really good. I really like that. These are also units that you're going to have for a long time. Even when you have the option to upgrade them to Gatling guns, you will sometimes choose not to do so because they lose one range, and ranged units kind of don't matter if they don't have range, right? Like the point of them is that they can shoot things from range. So you sort of want to hold off promoting these until you get plus one range on them, which is easier to do because they come out the gate with logistics. And then they have a library that's just better. Not only does it not cost you money, it makes you money. So I'm incentivized to do something I want to do anyway. It makes it easier for me to do that. I get a strong early game unit, and I get a very strong, relevant ranged unit. All of their stuff is good. They're not broken. Like, they're not. These abilities are not nearly as strong as get a free social policy every era, and, like, all of your horses are, like, twice as good as they used to be, or, like, you can destroy any military on the planet because you have the power of camels and Sinew. But they're still quite good. Like, all of their things are beneficial in pretty much any situation that you would want to apply them to. The only negatives and what keeps them from being up here is that China is not flexible. You play China, and then you make science and try to kill people. You can't really play another way. In the same way that, like, you can get ahead as Arabia and then play the economic game because you have bazaars, or like, Pakal can just pick which great person he wants, and that determines his play style. Or Poland can do whatever he flippin' well likes because he can essentially get a social policy treaty for free. China can't do that. So, yeah, this is my tier list. Feel free to call me out in the comments. I tried to make this as coherent as possible, and it's almost 2 hours long, so I'm going to stop the recording. Variety Channel, by the way. Later.